This is May 23rd, 2006, and I'm sitting here with Joe Maneri. We're talking about the duo recording with you and Peter Dolger. First, the St. Peter's Church, they built another facility in 1977, but
right.
You were in the facility that was there prior to that.
Yeah, when the church was there.
Right. It was the church of the Reverend John Garcia Gensel, one of the two or three most famous jazz priests of the time. Did you know the Reverend Gensel at the time that you did the concert?
Yes.
You did?
Yeah, I'd met him already.
How
did I be married?
I know about that. I'm going to get to that. But how did you, how and when did you meet him? Do you know?
Well, I met him through the... Jack Riley.
The pianist?
Yeah. The year is something I'm not positive about.
Mm-hmm.
But I know that it's between 62 and 64.
Okay, but it would have been before this gig.
And it would have been before this gig.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay.
But then he married us, didn't he?
Yeah, this is an interview.
Oh, sorry.
Were you aware of his reputation at the time as a minister who was supporting jazz?
Yes.
You didn't know about that?
Yes. See, Jack Riley, who was a student of mine, pianist,
yeah.
And Sheila Jordan used to do things together.
Uh-huh.
So Jack wrote a mass.
Okay.
And they performed it there.
Okay. And this is before...
I played there.
Okay.
And before I even met him.
Okay.
That's right.
Okay.
Before I met him. And then Jack would play there. So then I met him once when Jack was there. He had a nice little talk about. He said, "You ought to do a solo thing here and talk about God." Because I told him I was interested.
Mm-hmm.
I was a believer. And that was one evening where I got intermittent talking with him.
Riley?
Yeah. With Riley, introduced me.
Oh, okay. All right.
After the concert.
Well, this is... Riley was talking with you about meeting Gensel after the duo concert?
No. When I say after the concert...
Oh, after Riley's concert.
After Riley's concert.
With Sheila Jordan.
With Sheila Jordan.
Oh, okay.
And in Poor Motion, I think, was on it.
Uh-huh.
Anyhow... And then he says, "Maybe you ought to do a religious thing sometime." I said, "Yeah, I think I'd like to." So then a month or two passes, and Jack Riley calls me. He says, "There's a peace concert going on at the church, and we can't fill the entire 24 hours.
But he called you. He didn't call Dolger. He called you.
No, he called me.
Yeah.
Dolger wasn't, he didn't know Jack or anybody.
Okay. Yeah. And was Riley putting the concert on?
It was inspired, I think, by Gensel.
Oh, so it was Gensel's idea, probably.
I don't know this for sure, but I don't picture Jack Riley.
Okay.
In this capacity.
But Riley.
Gensel,
but Riley asked Gensel to get a hold of you or something like that.
No, Riley did that on his own.
Okay.
Because Riley was my student.
They needed people there to play.
Yeah, and he was my student.
Okay.
So he called me up. "You want to do it?" I said, "Yeah."
Now, did they specifically ask for the duo or just anything?
They just asked me to play.
Oh, okay.
Jack Riley did.
Okay.
And I said, "Well, I don't know who to play with." He says, "I think he might have said, well, what about Peter Dolger, you know?"
Okay.
That might have occurred.
Okay.
Well, however it went, I asked Peter Dolger, and that was it. They gave us the time. Mm-hmm. I think, I'm not sure if it was 1:30 in the morning or 2:30. It was after midnight.
Yeah. Do you remember any of the other musicians who performed at the concert?
The interesting thing was that I didn't meet any. Except for one man, and I don't know his name, saxophone player.
Okay.
Who was there. Because just didn't carry an audience after 12:30 or 1 in the morning.
Uh-huh.
So we had maybe about three people or four, maybe eight. I remember roughly about eight people were there.
Now, I'm guessing that Jack Riley played there, no?
Jack Riley was there.
I mean, in the audience, but did he play?
He did not play.
Oh, really? I don't mean with you, but did he play at any time?
Yes.
He did?
He played at one of the slots.
Okay. Okay.
I think with a trio.
Uh-huh. Specifically thinking now about the duo with Dolger, when was the first time you ever played this kind of music, specifically as a duo with Dolger?
Never.
Okay, I was under the impression that you had played this music, or you had done duo stuff with Dolger prior to this gig.
Well, before we made the other record, or the record, for 99?
Yes.
Which, of course, then didn't have a title.
Right.
He and I would rehearse as a duo, but not with the plan of being a duo.
Well, when you say rehearse as a duo, you mean like getting together and jamming?
And jamming, getting ready to do this record.
Okay, but did you play?
No, we didn't play duo. As a solo.
No, what I mean is, you said you got together as a duo to play. When you got together,
the material.
Yes.
Three of the pieces were written by Dolger. So when we got together to run down the heads.
Okay, so you were playing the Panniots 9 album type material when you worked together as a duo.
The heads,
right.
The heads.
But
right.
you didn't play the type of music that you played on this gig.
No.
Prior to that. So this is the first time you guys played what you might call essentially freely.
Yes. Second time, but this time was a duo. The first time was a record.
Are you talking about Panniots 9?
Panniots 9.
No, but you had composed hits on Panniots 9, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
This is completely uncomposed. I mean, there's nothing in here that's written.
No, nothing is written.
In the duo?
Nothing.
Right. But prior to playing in this duo, had you performed with him either as a duo or in some other capacity, doing completely free without any composed music?
No, because we played weddings.
Right,
that's
no.
What we did.
All right,
we
so
didn't
this
play
is,
jazz or anything.
So this concert at the church is the first time you two ever played completely
duo.
Free.
In public.
Or anywhere.
Well, anywhere, that's not.
Okay. Let's see. Move on to this. Approximately, now did you guys, after this duo in the church, did you ever play again as a duo doing completely improvised music?
No.
So this is a one-off, this is a one-time only.
What's that deal?
One time only deal.
Shortly after that, my God, we were steady wedding players.
Right.
And it was around that time that I stopped playing weddings. So we didn't even play at all.
You mean just prior to this concert? You didn't play together at all.
After that, not at all.
Not at all.
Not at all.
So, in other words, the experience at the church wasn't sufficient to get you guys to say, gee, we ought to try doing this some more?
Nope. Wow. There was no place to play.
No, I understand that. I understand that. Well, let me try this. Well, since it's the only time you ever played like this, do you remember your reaction at the end of the gig?
So, very natural.
But did you guys discuss the fact that it was completely different and completely improvised? And
didn't I want to know something? We took it for granted. Because we played weddings. And largely to a time when drums and clarinet keep going.
Yeah.
You know, a little bit.
And the fact that this was completely improvised was just an extension of other things that you had been
doing. Yeah. Now, we consider this very, you know.
Very natural.
Right.
Ah, okay. That's interesting.
Yeah, so, we didn't think like, oh, we're doing something. You know?
I'm sorry?
We didn't think that, oh, this is...
Oh, you didn't have a sense that this is something really different?
No.
Even though conceptually as being completely improvised and not starting from some composed place, it was somehow...
Yeah, it was funny because, you see, we were wedding players.
Yes.
And full time, that was our real job, so to speak, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So when we played the duo, we saw this as an extension of that, playing with the band, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Only we're playing without them. And of course, duo wasn't a thing that was unheard of. I mean, people did duos, I'm sure.
Right, but they did duos using heads,
mm-hmm.
you know? And that's the thing that's different about this, is there's no head. I mean, you take it for granted today because that's the way you play all the time.
Yeah.
But in terms of what was going on in music in general at the time, starting from scratch and just playing whatever you felt like playing,
right.
Completely improvised in 1963, 64 is very, in hindsight, is very odd.
Yes. And we weren't aware of it.
Okay.
Probably because we weren't in the jazz scene.
Possibly.
You know?
Yeah.
We weren't in the jazz scene. I mean, we respected jazz for jazz.
Yeah.
And we knew about culture.
But anybody who was doing something different wasn't really in the scene anyway.
Anyhow, so that...
I mean, they're kind of on the outskirts.
Anyhow.
You know, in some ways you have, you know, the experimental things of Eiler and so forth.
Yeah.
They weren't on the top 10 jazz albums of
right.
the year.
Right.
At the time. You know, one of the things that strikes me is Randy Peterson has performed on some of your albums. And I can hear a link between Randy's playing and Peter Dolger's playing in that church session. Has Randy ever heard this recording?
I think he has.
Prior to playing with you or recently?
No, during the time we were playing. Probably heard it about 10 years ago.
That early, yeah. Huh. I've...
10, 15 years.
Okay, so he may have been influenced by it somewhat.
Yeah. He's not a man who express things like that. Because I used to try to get it out of him.
Get what out of him?
He was influenced.
Oh, I see. Yeah, he wouldn't want to mention
influence. Himself.
Yeah, okay.
I mean, I wouldn't dare even ask him that. I had to come around the back road to the back of the house from the porch.
Yeah, okay.
he's very sensitive. So
yeah, well, a lot of people are.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So I had to be kind of, you know, but he knew what I was talking about.
Yeah.
So, you
know. Okay. So you think there might be a link there?
I think so. It's too little obvious.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, my thinking so... could be wrong too. Who knows?
Now you mentioned that he may have heard this 10 years or 15 years ago.
15 years maybe.
Okay. Now I've heard some of your other music from this period, such as your Serial Compositions and the Paniette's 9 recording, and yet this dual recording is the only music from that period that sounds like the music you're pursuing as an improviser today. It clearly predicts where you're going with your composed and improvised music today. You never mentioned this recording to me until fairly recently. In fact,
yes.
One of your students discovered it almost by accident. Over the years, we have talked about many different recordings and informal sessions that you've performed on, and yet until recently, you never mentioned this session to me. Why is it that you never brought it up?
Probably part of my personality, you know. I didn't talk about things I did much. I think because I didn't think they were very important. And
you didn't think this would be important, and why is that?
Enough to be... I think it's a personality problem of mine, you know.
Just because it was old, or...?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that's what you hit it. You know, because it was old, I'd say, "Oh, that's corny," and all that. I remember thinking that.
Yeah.
Do you actually feel that way now about the recording since you've heard it?
A little bit, no. Since people have told me that it's got a lot to it and that it's very special and that it has originality and all these things that people say it has, that's when I start to open up and be less shy about it.
Okay.
Otherwise, I wouldn't talk about it that much. As a matter of fact, I didn't get this recording until 3 years after the concert, or four. This was from a little tape recorder, you know, a little thing.
You mean in the church?
Yeah.
It was, but that was reel to reel in those days, right?
That was reel to reel. That's right.
That would have been a reel to reel deck.
But a little baby one.
Okay.
You know, maybe about this big. You know? And, or was it this big? I don't remember, but I know it was real smooth. And, but we weren't aware of the fact that he was recording it, you know? And then shortly after that, I came to the conservatory 5 years later. Well, it's 5 years. So it was about 5 years that the concert had passed up, because I came 1970 to the conservatory.
Well, if this is 63, five would be 68.
Right, okay. So it was that long. So then when I got it by mail.
So you were actually in the conservatory before you got it.
Exactly.
So you might have been 7 years or more.
Yes.
Wow.
Very possible.
Okay.
And then when I played it, I thought it was terrific, you know. And I started playing it for people.
Okay.
On and off. But I played mostly for Nights 9 for people. When they came over, I shied away from playing the duo all the time. Except for once a guy brought a duo of Coltrane with somebody, and he says, you got to hear your duo next to Coltrane, or you're not going to believe it. And what he was insinuating is my originality.
In what way?
In material.
You mean that you were so different from Coltrane?
Yeah, yeah. That I was, here was everybody, applauding Coltrane and playing, trying to play like him, and here I was, like...
Well, very different direction.
A whole different thing, you know?
Right.
And that he pointed out that it was the duo that Coltrane made was probably near the time that I made my duo. He wasn't that sure, but he thought it might have been near the
time. Actually, it probably would have been a little later. If I'm thinking of the session that probably is late in his career, it would have been later than your gig.
Okay.
But the point is, stylistically, you guys are working in a very different terrain.
Miles,
and both completely original. Yeah.
And of course, I wasn't really knowing Coltrane music because I was the type that didn't buy records. I never listened to anything because I was early on, when I was 18, 19, 20, 21, you know, I started to get really feeling that there was no chance that in a lifetime that I'd ever be in a jazz circle. So I just turned it off, so to speak, and didn't listen to anything, just like that.
Yeah.
Every now and then I'd meet a student that would bring me a record of Coltrane or Sonny Rollins, but I mean like a one-timer. They say, you want to hear this guy? You want to hear this? To that capacity, but I never owned records.
So you're probably listening more to other people today than you ever have in your life.
In my whole life.
Yeah.
And the only one I really, really listened to then was Lester Young.
Yeah.
I owned the Keynote 33 and a third. I owned a whole set of those, and that I listened to every minute. I loved it so much.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, so the Lester Young I was really aware of.
Yeah. Maybe a final question about this, which both you and Sonia have brought up already, is the Reverend Gensel married Sonia, and you. When was that? When did?
1965.
65. So it was a couple of years after this.
Yes.
Wow. And was it in St. Peter's?
Yeah.
Wow.
And Jack Farley improvised the music.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, that must have been great.
Yeah, and then Gensel improvised the service.
How do you mean that?
Well, he put readings of the Bible that he thought would be more appropriate for
me. You mean on the spot rather than preparing it?
Yeah, no preparations. He just got into it. He said, let's make a total improvisation out of this, you know.
Okay.
And we lit a candle together and a few other things like that.
Uh-huh.
And Riley played some very nice things.
And he was playing on the piano, not the organ, huh?
The piano.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And that was the only music at the session was in his...
Yeah, and the wedding, there was only 15 people
uh-huh.
at the wedding.
Were these people a variety of...
No, they were my parents, and
uh-huh.
her mother, and aunt, and the family. And
right,
and
no musician, just family.
His family.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
But the service was put on by jazz-oriented people.
That's right.
Yeah, that's kind of neat.
Yeah,
that's kind of special to think about.
I'll never forget it. Yeah.
Wow. And you two are still together after all these years, and
41 years, I think.
And so you have a house that's filled with art, sonically and visually, because of the work that the both of you do.
That's right. That's right.
And so it's kind of a wonderful marriage in a number of ways.
In a number of ways, that's correct. Yeah.
Okay. Well, is there anything else that I, you know, these are things that I wanted to know about the session. Are there any thoughts that you have about it that we haven't covered that you'd like to bring up?
Well, there was one thing that was personal.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was very strongly a witness for Christ. I used to go around and give talks.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had a conversion.
Yes.
During this time, and during the playing, there's one section in the playing that is really so original that I didn't even understand it. But I had a kind of a vision,
mm-hmm.
you know, like in my head. Of the Holocaust,
uh-huh.
and I started crying, and tears were coming out of my eyes, and I'm playing this act. It's very clear that I'm crying, even though you don't sound like tears, but the horn cries.
Mm-hmm.
And I did altissimo and kind of a, you know, grabbing dirt from the earth and just pulling it out. Just ragging it out and lifting it up. That's what it kind of sounds like.
Mm.
And I was totally not myself there. That section of it is the key note of that whole session, where I was more original than anything I had ever done in my life. Since then, I don't think I have done anything quite as original.
You don't think you can top that moment?
Yeah,
right?
Yes. It's a little section.
Yes, I know what you mean. Yeah,
but it's very extremely original.
Wow.
Today it sounds normal.
Well, that's what I mean. Is I think you've had a number of moments like that in performances. Now, mm-hmm. now you may not think, you know, that's interesting. You say that was kind of like the peak even for today, because you've had experiences somewhat comparable to that since that time.
Yes, that's right. Not quite with tears and
mm-hmm.
such, you know, but just performance,
mm-hmm.
you know, getting caught up into it and being spiritually excited.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm glad you brought that up, because I seem to remember you mentioning this before to me in conversation in passing. But I'm glad that we've documented
it. I always make sure to bring that up, because that is the key of the whole album.
Yeah.
I mean, there's other keys. I mean, you know, there's the beginning, for instance, I kind of had in my mind's eye, there's a long beginning, which I always dreamed I'd do it in improv.
Mm-hmm. Prior to that?
Yes, mm-hmm. but I never did it.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually did it on this,
uh-huh.
you know. I did something that I had calculated I might do, and I did it.
Mm-hmm.
And today it sounds different, you know, that too. It's a long breath of about 5 minutes,
mm-hmm.
and almost getting excited but never letting go, always holding back, mm-hmm. almost like pulling it back and not letting it go.
Mm-hmm. And these are things you're talking about, you know, because the thing that's obvious to someone who listens to your music today is the things you're talking about are setting the table for what you're doing today.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
This is the foundation of your yeah. music today, to a great extent. Even your composed work, to some extent.
Yes, yes, that's right, that's right.
Yeah, yeah. Quite remarkable. Quite
yeah.
remarkable. Is there anything else that...
anything else about the whole thing?
Sure.
No, there's only one thing. Pete was high on pot.
Why don't we leave it at that?
Yeah. But in a way, he let loose on that.
Yeah.
We not that we had an arrangement, because it was all improvised.
Yeah.
But there's a few places where we did things we don't ever do, you yeah. know. And that was due to the spontaneity and his
yes.
freedom.
Inebriation, yes.
Yeah.